Thank you. All right, hey, thanks for joining us for Good Friday. Why don't you guys stand to your feet? Come on, we're going to worship a little bit together tonight. We're going to sing some praise. We're going to thank our God because our God is who He said He is. Come on, all my words.
All my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do. But every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands, praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
Come on, one thing I know about worship, church, is that oftentimes if we're not careful, we'll let our circumstance dictate our praise. But I'm here to tell you that sometimes we need to let our praise dictate our circumstance. And even when life is not good, we need to remind ourselves that we serve a good God, a God that is still in control, a God that can make a way when there seems to be no way. So come on, when we sing this bridge, I want you to lift up your voice. I want you to remind your soul tonight on this Good Friday that you serve a God who is on your side, and He gave you a voice to lift up His praise. Come on, let's sing this out. Yeah.
Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Come on, one more time.
Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Hey. Throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, it's nothing else fit.
Come on, let's join heaven tonight.
Gathered at the highest throne, welcomed by a melody, an anthem I have always known, a song that's always been in me. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar, forever echo, holy is the Lord. Oh, oh, forever echo, holy is the Lord. Memorized by every heart, written in eternity. Voice apart, joining in the symphony. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you.
Come on, all wisdom.
All wisdom and wonder belong to no other but you. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar, forever echo, holy is the Lord. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, forever echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar, forever echo, holy is the Lord. Oh, oh, forever echo, holy is the Lord.
Oh, 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 oh,
the perfect Son of God, in all his innocence, he walking in the dirt with you and me. He knows what living is, he's acquainted with our grief. A man of sorrow, son of suffering. Oh, blood and tears, how can it be? There's a God who weeps, there's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Distant and removed, but you chased us down in merciful pursuit. To the sinner you were grace, and the broken you embraced. And in the end, the proof is in your wounds.
Yeah.
In the end, the proof is in your wounds. Oh, blood and tears, how can it be? There's a God who weeps, there's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing. All praise King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven. Your blood still speaking, your love still reaching. All praise King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven. Your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing. All praise King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven. Your blood still speaking, your love still reaching. All praise King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven. Glory to God in heaven. Glory to God in heaven. Glory to God in heaven.
Come on, church, we have to understand tonight. Yes, I know Easter is coming. Yes, I know Jesus is alive today. But we can't forget the reality that at one point our Savior hung on a cross. He died for us. He left those nails in his hands. He left that crown of thorn on his head. He took that suffering upon himself. Because through that cross, we can have freedom. Through his stripes, we can have healing. So let's declare that out together again tonight, that it's by the power of the cross that we can walk in this thing called a new life with Jesus. Come on.
Your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing. All praise King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven. Your love.
Your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing. All praise King Jesus.
Glory to God in heaven. Your blood still speaking, your love still reaching. All praise King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven. blood and tears, how can it be? There's a God who weeps, there's a God who bleeds.
Oh, praise the one who would reach for me.
Hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for your love. We sing hallelujah tonight because on the other side of this war, on the other side of the cross, we know what has happened. But oh God, let us not forget that you are the Son of Suffering, that we serve a God who loves us, that he became one with us. He took on flesh. He left the glory of heaven. And he walked on this earth only at the end of his life to give up his life. So Lord, we pray as we continue to worship you tonight, Father, in this house, that your presence would be here, that Holy Spirit, you would know you are welcome here just as in heaven. And Lord, we pray that on this Good Friday that souls would be saved, that sickness would be defeated, that marriages would be restored, that addictions would be broken, that depression would flee, and that the hope of Jesus would come alive in this place. We love you, Lord. It's in your precious and holy name, all of God's people said. Amen. Come on, church, all of God's people said. Amen. Amen. You guys can take a seat.
It was meant to stop insurrection. It was meant to put down Jesus, but instead it set up his resurrection. It was meant to jeer and mock him, but instead it was his glory. It was meant to erase a chapter, but instead it became the story. It was meant to hold up convicts, but instead it raised up a king. It was meant to shut our mouth, but instead it's why we sing. It was meant to be a judgment, but instead it became our mercy. It's why the song of heaven is the Lamb. The Lamb is worthy. It was meant to kill an enemy, crush dissenters and diversion, but instead it became the banner of God's love for every person. It was meant to be appalling, nailing hands and feet to wood. It was meant to be used for evil, but instead it was used for good. It was meant to be a symbol of God's assassination, but instead, it became the symbol of Jesus' invitation. Come to the cross. Instead of sin and stain, you are meant to be made clean. Instead of being forgotten, you are meant to know your sin. Instead of being ashamed, you can leave behind your guilt. Instead of feeling empty, you were meant to be fulfilled. Instead of being broken, you are meant to be made whole. Here, Calvary is calling. It beckons you. Behold, come to the cross. Instead of being an accident, you have a purpose and a plan. Instead of being abandoned, you were chosen by His hand. For all who've said, I can't, God has said, I can. No matter what you've done, the invitation stands. Come to the cross. Instead of being doubtful, you are meant to know your Father. You are meant to be His son, and you are meant to be His daughter. You were cherished from the start. You are always in the picture. Instead of being a victim, you are meant to be a victor. The result of Jesus' blood, salvation has arrived. Instead of being dead, you are meant to be alive. Cross. It was meant to signal death, but instead, it's a sign of living. It was meant to be the end, but instead, it's our beginning.
As Jesus was preparing to go to the cross, in a moment of prayer, He cried out, "Everything is possible for you. Please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine." You see, church, we've got to understand so many times in life, we can ask the question, God, what is your will? I don't know about you, but I want to live my life inside the will of God. And we have to, for just a moment, we have to grasp the reality that Jesus gave up His deity to be born of a virgin, to live this perfect, sinless life. And in this moment, even the Savior of the world had one request: let my life be God's will. Did it mean it would be easy? Absolutely not. You see, for those who might be asking tonight, what is the will of God? I believe this prayer of Jesus gives us the answer. The will of God was to send His Son to die so that through Him we may find life. It's an upside down paradox. It doesn't make sense that somebody has to die in order for us to live. But when we look at the Bible says that the consequence of sin is death. And I don't know about you, but I'm far from perfect. I'm far from sinless. And so my life that I live, the shortcomings that I have, the consequence for my life should be death. But Jesus took a cross and He carried it to Calvary and He hung on that cross knowing that He was not guilty. Knowing He did not deserve the punishment, but knowing that it could change our eternity. Church, God doesn't just want what's best for your life. He is what's best for our life. And when we grasp that, when we understand that, that His love for us is so overwhelming, then it changes everything. You see, I've read all the things this week and today, all the posts on Facebook, recounting everything that our Savior went through. All the punishment, all the whipping, all the bruises. And I don't want to stand up here and recount all of those things for you. But I want to tell you one thing I know that is true. In that moment, Jesus had all the power and authority to change everything. Like, do you understand that? He was still God while still fully man. He could have changed the entire scenario. He could have, if he wanted, removed himself from the cross. And yet, three nails, one in each hand, and one through his feet, is what kept him there. But I don't believe it was the nails that kept our Savior on the cross. I believe it was his love. It wasn't the nails that held him there. It was you, and it was me. You see, because in life we go through seasons, we go through experiences, we go through loss, and we find ourselves looking for hope. And in that moment on that cross, I can tell you this, Jesus hung on the cross. So church, we could hang on to hope. We could know that no matter what happens in our life, no matter what way the world goes, we can have a hope in the Savior, in the Savior of the world, in the God of the universe, to know that he is still in control. It was love that held him on the cross. And even in his final moments, before he took his last breath, a conversation awakens. Because we've all seen the picture. There was not one cross, but there were three at Calvary. And on both sides, to his left and to his right, were sinners. Were men who were accused because they were guilty. And yet in the middle, the Savior of the world, who did not deserve to be there. And a conversation arises between the three. And one sinner on the cross begins to mock the Savior of the world. Aren't you God? If you really are who you say you are, can't you just take yourself down from there? And I believe it was probably to the surprise of everyone in that moment, the sinner on the other cross cries out, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. The Savior of the world is hanging on a cross. He's been whipped 39 times. He's carried his cross. He's fallen. He's picked it back up. He's carried it further. He's got a crown of thorns on his head, blood rushing down his body. And in a moment, when a sinner who is guilty to be in the position he's in cries out, "Oh Lord, have mercy on me. Remember me when you enter into your kingdom." Our Savior was less concerned about his position and more interested in that man's salvation. And I want to tell you something, church. That's Jesus's position when it comes to every single one of us. You see, I believe the cross was Jesus's lowest point of his life. Up until this point, he traveled from town to town. Miracles were following him everywhere he went. Crowds were flocking. On Sunday, the streets were lined with people shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna." And yet on Friday, he's covered in blood and nailed to a cross. The lowest point of our Savior's life. And can I tell you what he did? He still made you his greatest priority. Because in a moment where all pain was on him, in a moment where all suffering was placed upon his body, when all the weight of our sin was placed on the Savior of the world, he made you his greatest priority. Because he knew that this is what it would take. It was going to take the cross. And all throughout Jesus' time, he prophesied of what was to come. He told the disciples, there will come a day when I will leave. There will come a day where I will no longer be with you. And in one moment in John 15, while Jesus is teaching a parable of a vine and the branches, he makes this declaration. There is no greater love than this, to lay down your life for a friend. And I want to remind you tonight that that's exactly what the Savior of the world did for you. He laid down his life. You see, in this moment, the symbol of the cross is changing. You know, many times we look at crosses today and we forget that at one moment, the cross was a dreaded symbol. It wasn't something worth celebrating. It wasn't something the Jews had plastered on their wall in their home. No, the cross was a symbol of death. But can I tell you what Jesus did on that Good Friday? He turned a symbol of death into a testament of love. And now we carry the cross. And now we hold the cross high because it has changed everything for this world. So I want to challenge you tonight to come to the cross. Maybe you're in need of salvation. Maybe tonight you would say, I need forgiveness. I need to receive this kind of love. I've never had somebody love me that way. Can I tell you one of the hardest things for me to comprehend early on when I gave my life to Jesus was, yes, I understood that God loved me. But can I tell you what took a little bit longer? I also had to learn that God liked me. Like, he wants to be your friend. Like, you gotta understand that, y'all. Jesus wants to be your friend. Jesus likes to spend time with you. He likes when you talk to him. He likes when you sit in his presence. He doesn't just love you. He likes you. And his invitation is this: meet me at the cross. And the reason he invites us to the cross is because it's at the cross where he changed everything for us. We don't have to do anything yet come into his presence. We don't have to do anything but repent of our sin. Y'all, the victory's been won. The battle is over. So the invitation stands, come to the cross. If it's forgiveness you're seeking tonight, come to the cross. If it's an outpouring of love you need in your life, come to the cross. If you find yourself helpless and hopeless tonight, come to the cross. If you feel like you're facing a storm that's overwhelming, come to the cross. If it's healing you need, come to the cross. You know, Jesus took 39 whippings. And historians would account the reason he took 39 is because it was known that 40 would kill a man. Can I tell you another revelation I received this week that changes everything? The Bible declares by his stripes we are healed, yes? How many whippings did Jesus take? 39. Scientists have studied disease all across this world. And every disease that exists can be traced back to 39 roots. By his stripes we are healed. Jesus took one stripe for every root of disease. And so if it's healing you need, come to the cross. If it's restoration you need, come to the cross. If it's freedom over an addiction you need, come to the cross. If it's deliverance you need, come to the cross. If it's a miracle you need, oh, come to the cross. If it's breakthrough you're searching for, come to the cross. You see, sometimes in life it can feel like every situation we're in is a setback. It's a setback. It's a setback. And on Wednesday night, I preached a message to our youth, and God reminded me that the cross appeared to be a setback in the moment, but it was only a setup for a miracle. And I don't know what setback you're facing, but I'm here to tell you, when you come to the cross and in the hands of Jesus, that setback can become a setup for a miracle in your life. Come to the cross. If you just need the reminder tonight that you are never alone, come to the cross. Come on, let's pray tonight. I want to tell you that the cross is a symbol of love. And in that moment, Jesus did not just prioritize the sinner next to him who cried out for mercy, who cried out for forgiveness, and who desired to long to be in the presence of Jesus for his entire life. The priority of Jesus' heart in that moment was for all to call upon the name of Jesus. For all who are needing forgiveness to come to him and receive it. For all who are in need of mercy to come to the cross and receive it. And so tonight I want to give you a chance to come to the cross. The Bible says if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and he was raised on the third day, you shall be saved. And y'all, I'm here to tell you tonight, your Father in heaven loves you. But sometimes it's hard to comprehend something such as a crucifixion that we call good if you've not yet responded to the good news. And so tonight, I want you to know Jesus' posture remains the same as it did on the cross. Arms wide open, ready to receive you, ready to call you home, ready to call you son, ready to call you daughter, ready to forgive you of every mistake you've done, ready to wash you and to make you clean. But it's an invitation, and we make the response. And so tonight I want to ask you, if you're in this place or you're worshiping with us online, wherever you are, would you receive the message of the cross in your life tonight? Would you realize that you serve a God who loves you so much that in order to call you son, he sent his son to die? That in order to call you daughter, he sacrificed his only child? Because he thought in that moment that you're worth it. So if you're in the room tonight or online and you would say, I need that kind of love in my life, maybe for the first time, or let's be honest, church, maybe we need a fresh outpouring of his love because it's been a long time since we've experienced it. If that's you tonight, I just want to ask you to do one thing. It's going to be bold. It's going to be brave. But every eye closed, every head bowed. I just want to ask you to slip your hand up. There's hands all over the room. Come on, I believe Jesus wants you to know that you're loved. In his lowest point, you were his greatest priority.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There were hands all over this room. I know there were probably hands raised, those joining us online, but I want to pray and I want to invite all of us, those who are coming to the cross for the first time, and those who might be returning to the cross tonight, maybe just to thank God for your salvation. As a follower of Jesus, the Bible says we all fall short, and so I want to lead us in a prayer, and many would say it's the sinner's prayer, but I believe it's a prayer of repentance, because we need to repent daily, y'all. And sometimes, even though we've been following Jesus for a long time, we need to remind ourselves of everything he's done for us and what he's going to continue to do. So if you raised your hand, or you would already say in this room tonight you're a follower of Jesus, would you join me out loud as we declare with our mouth what we believe in our heart? Jesus, I commit my life into your hands. I repent of my sin. I declare with my mouth, because I believe in my heart, you are Lord of my life. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. Thank you for coming back to life 3 days later. I submit my life to you. I surrender my will to you. And from this moment forward, you are Lord of my life, over all of my life, for the rest of my life. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Come on, church, declare amen together tonight. Amen, amen, and amen. Man, I'm telling you, God is good. His love is, it can't be compared to anything, church. And I want to go back into a time of worship tonight. You know, tonight is meant to be a little bit different. And I know we started at 6. I don't know what time we'll get done. If God wants to do something, we're going to let him. But I know one thing, as Jesus was getting ready to end his life, as he was getting ready to go to the cross, he gathered with his disciples for one last supper. And while they were all sitting at the table, Jesus took the bread. And the Bible says after giving thanks, he broke it and he began to hand it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which has been broken for you. Take and eat of it. Do this in remembrance of me." And then the Bible would go on to say that as supper was continuing, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he had shared the cup. And he told his disciples, "Take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant, which has been poured out for you. Take and drink. Do this in remembrance of me." And so tonight, as we come to the cross, I want to invite us as a church to also come to his table. You know, here at our church, we've got a lot of people from a lot of different backgrounds. And if you're new here, I want you to know we practice open communion. And here's why I believe that. Because even if you do not yet believe that Jesus's body was broken for you, guess what? His body was broken for you. Even if you haven't received the truth that his blood was shed for you, guess what? His blood has been shed for you. And I believe that even Judas had a seat at his table. And sometimes we need a moment of reflection of our own life to realize, to reflect, and to recognize the sacrifice that our Savior paid. And so as we go back into a time of worship, I'm going to just invite us as a church to take your elements as you feel led. The altar's open if you need to come and spend time at the altar tonight. We're going to have a few guys up front to pray with you if you need prayer, if you're agreeing for God to do something in your life, if you're in need of a miracle, if you need a touch from heaven to heal your body. We want to stand in agreement with you tonight in prayer, but we're just going to go back into a time of worship. We're going to invite God to move. And I'm going to invite you to come to the cross and to join us at the table. Let's continue to worship Him in this house tonight.
Is the flow that
my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. No precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood.
Going and you're weeping and rejoicing.
We can forget that, y'all, because let's be honest, sometimes life isn't good, but we serve a God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Yes, He is. Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come rest over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. Here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me. Feel us afresh. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me. Tell him tonight. Yeah. Holy Spirit, come rest on me. You're all I want. You're all I want. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. Yeah. You're all we want. Guys, I want you to know what happens in Acts chapter 2. The day of Pentecost, after Jesus ascended, the Holy Spirit comes and fills those gathered in the upper room. But I want to tell you something. The power of the Holy Spirit did not die with those in the room. But because Jesus is alive, we have access to that same Spirit today. And so I'm just telling you, if you've never asked God, Lord, fill me with your Spirit. I need an outpouring of the Holy Spirit in my life. I want to invite you to do that tonight, because I'm telling you, you do not know the authority of Jesus until you walk full of his Spirit. So just invite him tonight. Oh, we love you, Lord. Yeah. Come on, just sing this out.
Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. The room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Children, may his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening.
You're coming in your glory and you're weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you.
Come on, tonight, if you're in the room or even online, I just want to ask you to just open your hands as if someone was physically placing a gift into them. I want you to just hear these words as we declare them over you tonight, as we close tonight. That you would receive these words in your heart, to know that your God has good plans for you. Not just plans for you, but for your family, for your children, for your children's children. And that when all the world is lost and broken and hurting, and chaos ensues all around us, that your God would give you the peace that surpasses all understanding, so you can continue to walk with the power of the cross alive in your heart, to know the hope of Jesus reigns forever and ever. Just receive this time. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Come on, one more time. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a Jesus, we thank you that on this night, 2,000 some years ago, the world stood silent, thinking all hope was lost, and yet little did they know. And while the world was silent, a war was being waged. And as you stormed the gates of hell, you were fighting on our behalf, taking the keys from the devil's kingdom, only to be prepared to come out of that tomb on that Easter morning. So as we leave tonight, Lord, allow our hearts to meet you in that place. The place of understanding that it was our suffering you took. It was our shame that you wore. It was our sin that took you there. Only to know that when we come back together on that Sunday morning, we can rejoice because the tomb is empty. We pray this all in your holy, precious, powerful name that is above every other name. It's in the name of Jesus we pray, and all of God's people said.